live NFL trivia every Tuesday night on Twitch at 9 p.m. Eastern. Come show off your football knowledge and have a chance to win cash prizes. Check the link in the description to find out more. And now, on with our feature presentation. For many people, when they think of the New York Jets, the first player that comes to mind is none other than Broadway Joe himself. Joe Namath is perhaps the greatest Jet of all time, and there's a reason he's in the Hall of Fame, forever enshrined in canon. He was arguably the first celebrity quarterback in the history of pro football. He led the league in passing yards 3 times, was the first player in pro football history to throw for over 4,000 yards in a single season, made 5 Pro Bowls and All-Star games, and is arguably the greatest quarterback in the history of the AFL. And of course, there's the thing that most people best remember Namath for, which is winning Super Bowl III after famously guaranteeing his victory. But what you might not know is that Super Bowl III was very nearly the last game of his career, because 6 months after winning the Super Bowl, achieving the pinnacle, and being atop the football world, Joe Namath announced his retirement. And this is the story behind the bizarre and unexpected retirement of Broadway Joe. Before I talk about the retirement, we need some context as to just who Joe Namath was, so that we can understand the magnitude of this announcement. In 1965, both the New York Jets of the American Football League and the St. Louis Cardinals of the National Football League drafted the Alabama quarterback. In what was considered a major turning point for the legitimacy of the AFL, Namath decided to play in New York and join the Jets. With that, the legend of Broadway Joe began, as he turned the Jets from a laughingstock and an afterthought to a household name. His impact off the field could not be overstated. Consider this. In 1962, the Jets, then known as the New York Titans, drew 36,164 fans. That's not a per-game average. That was their total season attendance. On a per-game average, it's slightly over 5,100 fans per game. During Namath's first season, the Jets did not have a single game with less than 53,000 people in the stands. And he backed the hype up on the field. As a rookie, he made it to the AFL All-Star Game. He followed it up by leading the league in passing yards in 1966 and 1967, making it to another All-Star Game during the 1967 campaign, and becoming the first quarterback to ever throw for 4,000 yards. Fun fact, as of the date this video went live, this 1967 season was literally the only time that a Jets quarterback has thrown for 4,000 yards in a season. But all this was building up to a 1968 campaign that would not be forgotten. In 1968, Namath started every game as he was named a first-team All-Pro and an All-Star. He led the Jets to the postseason for the first time in franchise history, as they won the AFL East with an 11-3 record. He led the Jets to an AFL title after throwing 3 touchdown passes against the Oakland Raiders. And then at Super Bowl III, he guaranteed a victory over the Baltimore Colts, who were heavily favored by 18 points. Then he backed up his guarantee by leading the Jets to arguably the biggest upset in the history of pro football, and maybe the history of American professional sports. He completed over 60% of his passes and was named the MVP of the big game as the Jets stunned the Colts and won by a final score of 16-7. Just like that, Broadway Joe wasn't just the biggest name in football, but was one of the biggest names in all of pop culture. But little did anyone know at the time, including Namath himself, that at the peak of his career, on top of the world, he was about to ride off into the sunset and never play again. Namath wasn't just a pro football player, he was a businessman, and during the 1968 season, he bought a bar with 2 other guys for $50,000 on Lexington Avenue, known as Bachelor's 3. The location was great, and the bar got a ton of publicity since it was Namath's bar. Who wouldn't want to go there and maybe catch a glimpse at the biggest star in America? The bar was a hit and was packed every single night, and because of the bar's status, it attracted some, let's just say, shady people. There was a set of payphones downstairs, and often, you would have the mafia, mobsters, and bookies on the phones. Now, did Namath know any of these people personally? Well, he didn't personally know all of them. Namath admitted to knowing one of them personally, with that being JoJo Davidson, a bank robber. Of the other people involved, with at least 13 being involved and 11 being gamblers and thieves, all of them got to know Namath, or at the very least, got to rub shoulders with him. And this worried one man in particular. That man, as you might have guessed, was NFL Commissioner Pete Rozelle. You have to understand the dilemma that the NFL was in back then. There were some serious concerns about pro football being rigged. Just a few years before, in 1963, Rozelle suspended Packers halfback Paul Harding and Lions defensive tackle Alex Karras for betting on games, and fined 5 other Lions players for betting on the 1962 NFL Championship. Gambling on pro football was starting to become more and more popularized as the sport was growing in popularity. And now you had the star of pro football owning a bar where bookies frequently stop by. When Rozelle found out about the type of people frequenting Namath's bar, he was worried about the integrity of the sport, since any sort of evidence that the games are rigged can torpedo the popularity of the league. As Rozelle later said, "I learned this from Burt Bell and Kenesaw Landis, the former commissioner of baseball. If you lose public confidence in a sport, you're in trouble." With that, Rozelle gave Namath two options. Either sell your stake in the bar in the next 48 hours, or you're out of pro football. And Namath was furious about this, to the point where, to the shock of everyone, he was about to walk away from the game just 6 months after winning the Super Bowl. On June 6, 1969, speaking at his bar, Namath announced to the world that he was walking away from the game.
"If I didn't sell, I would be suspended. Well, I'm not selling. I'll quit. This is ridiculous."
To say that Pete Rozelle was shocked that Namath actually went this route would be an understatement. Rozelle said that he wanted to talk to Namath, and later that day, held a press conference saying, "I would like to see Joe Namath play football very much." And initially, Namath was going to sell the restaurant and comply with Rozelle's orders. But out of principle, he decided not to do it. As Namath said, "It was logical, but it wasn't right, and I couldn't go through with it." Namath tried to do both, and tried to get back to pro football while keeping his stake in the bar. A week later, Namath hired a private eye to screen gamblers and potential mafia members before entering the establishment to try and get back into Rozelle's good graces. It didn't work. He received legal advice from O.J. Simpson. It didn't work. I'm guessing O.J.'s advice of "if the bookies don't admit, you must acquit" didn't help him a whole lot. He met with Rozelle later in the month to try and sort things out. It went nowhere. Rozelle wanted Namath to sever all ties with the bar, and Namath initially refused. When training camp started for the Jets, Namath was not there. He was still retired. The Jets were going to ride into the 1969 season with Babe Parilli, the 39-year-old veteran and three-time All-Star, as their main man under center. There was even a report that Namath changed his mind and was ready to be at the Hofstra camp once it began, but that turned out to be a lie, as he was absolutely nowhere to be found. Finally, Namath and Rozelle met again in the middle of July, just a few weeks after their last meeting, and they hashed out their differences. Turns out, Rozelle really liked Namath, praising him for being professional about everything, and the fact that he had no personal vendetta against him. And as it turns out, during these talks and negotiations, Rozelle didn't have to give up anything. He got exactly what he wanted, because Namath was desperate to play pro football again. And with that, Namath was back in professional football. After being retired for 6 weeks, and looking like he was never going to play again, Namath sold his stake in Bachelors 3 and rejoined the New York Jets. And our story does not end there. On the way to the press conference, where Rozelle and Namath would announce what happened, Namath caught a taxi cab. The cab driver recognized Namath, and after identifying him, said, according to the story, "Fudge Pete Rozelle." Obviously, he didn't use that word, but you can use your imagination to figure out what exactly the cab driver said. Once at the press conference, Namath said that he did nothing wrong, and that he really wanted to stick to his guts. But he decided to give in to Rozelle's request because he wanted to play football, and he didn't want to let his teammates and his family down. Namath returned to the Jets shortly after the over-month-long retirement, and he picked up right where he left off in 1968. During that 1969 season, he once again started all 14 games for the club, being named an All-Star while finishing second in the league in passing yards and passing touchdowns. He even led the Jets to another appearance in the postseason, as for the second straight year, the Jets won the AFL East Division title. And despite almost retiring at the end of the 1968 season, Namath played another decade in pro football, and wouldn't retire until 1977 after a weird four-game stint with the Los Angeles Rams. By the time Joe Namath retired, he was one of the all-time greats in football, and a pioneer in establishing the legitimacy of the AFL. He finished his career at the time inside the top 15 in pro football history in passing touchdowns, and inside the top 10 in passing yards. Nobody would ever wear the number 12 jersey again for the Jets, and in 1985, for his contributions to the game, he was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And to think that it almost all came to an end a decade before it actually did, all because of a bar in the heart of New York City. They don't call him Broadway Joe for nothing. Be sure to like this video, ring the notification bell, subscribe down below if you haven't already, so it helps the channel out a lot. And be sure to check out Twitch every Monday and Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern for your chance to play NFL trivia and win cash prizes. Link in the description below. If you want to see videos like this condensed down to 60 seconds, then follow me on TikTok at Jarrogator9, and subscribe to 60 Second NFL History on YouTube. To see highlight videos of players throughout the history of the NFL, subscribe to JG9 Highlights. Also, special thanks to all of our Patreon supporters for helping the channel. Your support is greatly appreciated. So you can become a patron and request future video topics in the description below.